Well, the topic of this lecture is rather clear and perhaps also simple, but it is nonetheless a provocation. Because you know that we always spoke about political economy, or in German also Nationalökonomie, national economy. And then we learned since the beginning of the 90s of the last century, that is after the disappearance of actually existing socialism as an alternative to the capitalist development, we spoke about globalization. Globalization as the outcome of the long history since the beginning of the 16th century of the capitalist world system, which came into existence as Fernand Braudel, the great historian in France, said in the long 16th century, beginning with 1492, the so-called discovery of the two Americas, and then with the peace treaties of Westphalia in the year 1648. The one was the data, the one was the beginning of that what we are accustomed to call the capitalist world system, and the whole school of thinkers are following the idea of the capitalist world system. That is a system which is open to discover and to conquer the whole planet Earth on the one hand, and on the other hand, 1648, the peace of Osnabrück and Münster in Germany, the Westphalian peace, that was the beginning of the international order of nation states, that is a world of new frontiers, a world of new limits, of new borders, and not the white world system which is conquering and expanding on the whole planet Earth. That is what was the discourse until the end of the 20th century, so to say. But since then, many people are going to speak about that, what John Sachs Fernandez mentioned about the Anthropocene or the Capitalocene. Only few who use this term, the Capitalocene, but it exists, saying that it is not only the economy which is characteristic and conquering the whole earth, but it is also the ecology, that is the nature of planet Earth, which is globalized, not only the economy, not only the political system. For the political system and of its analysis, we have categories, categories of international politics. And we have also categories in economics to analyze, not only the national economy, but also the international economy, the global economic system. And we also know about the political and economic regulation of the system, that is a system of governance, as it has been called. But now we also are aware of the discovery and of the conquest of the ecology, of nature, of the planet Earth, not at least because we are going to destroy this nature of planet Earth. We are in the midst of the climate catastrophe. We are amidst in, as some call it, because they counted it, in the sixth extinction, wave of extinction in the history of the Earth. And that means that we have to take into account not only the history of the capitalist world system, of modernity and so on, but we have to take into account also the history of planet Earth, and that is millions of years, not only 500 years as in the capitalist world system, not only 2,000 years as since the emergence of Christianity and of modernity of the great religions of the Islam, Christianity, of Judaism, and other great religions. But we have to take into account the history also of planet Earth, the disappearance of species, and on the other hand, the new and existence and the birth of new species in the history of the world. Perhaps you know the differentiation or the distinction in the thinking of the great historian, which I already mentioned, Fernand Braudel, who said that we are living in the history, in one history only, but this history has different layers. There is a short-term history of events, and then we have middle-range historical developments of some decades, perhaps, of one generation, perhaps two, and we have very, very long-term developments of several hundred years. And then we have perhaps to add that we have also mega-long or super-long cycles of historical developments of thousands and perhaps 10,000s and perhaps also 100,000s and millions of years, which are also present in the history of the short term. They are present. And we have to analyze the present in the short term with respect to the middle range historical developments and the very long term developments and the longue durée, as it has been called, Fernand Braudel in French, in his language, that is in the history of the capitalist system in the last several hundred years. So that is what we have to do, because we are challenged by events which have a very, very long history, like the extinction of species, with consequences for the evolution of these species. And one of the species on Earth, one of the living species on Earth, that is human beings, that are we. And therefore, this long-term history of the species, of evolution, it has an impact, it has consequences for ourselves in the present, that is in the short term, in the middle range, and so on. That we have to take into account, and that is what we have to learn from the new developments, also in science, which discovered the developments of the economic system, of the politics, of war and peace, in the last 20 years after the collapse of actually existing socialism, and which has also consequences on the history of the economic system, which has a longer history than that of the politics, but not so long as the development of species or of other Earth systems. And we are also we also have to take into account the development of Earth system, and not only of economic, political, social systems, and so on, because we are faced with problems which are stemming from these Earth systems. What are these Earth systems? It was an economist, Kenneth Boulding, who said in the 60s already that our planet Earth, or our spaceship Earth, as he entitled a rather famous article which he wrote in these times, and he said there are many, several Earth systems. The one Earth system is climate. But climate is only understandable when we analyze energy as an Earth system. Without energy, there is no life on Earth, there is no development, there is no economy on Earth. And we have another Earth system, that is information. And that information is so important today is very, very clear after the scandal of Snowden and the data theft by the NSA in the United States and the end of privacy in the internet because of data theft and the domination of the information system for controlling developments on every spot on the surface, and not only on the surface of planet Earth. Information today is also an Earth system, and we have to take it into account in order to understand what is happening in the actual development on this planet Earth, from the Americas to Europe and from Asia to Australia. That is what we have to take into account. Well, the long-term history. And now we... I skip some of the exhibits and say that we have to be aware that all these... Okay, yes. That all these systems on Earth have one common basis. And this common basis is the factum brutum, the bad fact that this planet Earth is a limited planet. But we forget that it has limits, mostly. We act as if planet Earth has no borders, no limits. And we can act on Earth as if it were, would be a borderless planet. That is our common understanding today. And that has to do with the ideology which John mentioned, that is neoliberalism, which is an ideology which doesn't know space and time. And when you don't know space and time, then you don't know limits, and then you can act as if there are borderless perspectives for human action. But that is not so. And it is not so, and this knew already great philosophers like Immanuel Kant. And I quoted him because he said, and I read this quotation, that the planet, the surface of planet Earth is limited, and therefore you have to follow some maxims. The categorical imperative, for instance, act only according to that maxim whereby you can at the same time will that it should become a universal law. And that means that you cannot act in a way that not other people on Earth, your neighbors, but also your neighbors very far away from you can do the same without having harmful effects on others. So you have to take into account in your activities that these limits exist and that you have to follow these limits. That is what is of utmost importance. The limits, therefore, are a factum which you cannot change, but in theory, the dominant theory today, in the hegemonic discourse, it seems so as if you have not to follow these limits, as if there is endless accumulation of capitalism, as if there is endless and unlimited growth of GNP. You know that in Brazil, for instance, but also in Germany, they have been negotiated and then established laws of acceleration of economic growth. It's a politically made political decision to increase the growth, to accelerate the growth as if there are no limits. It's a law, as if there are no limits. That has been done by the Lula government in Brazil 2009, and that has also been decided upon by the German parliament 2 years later, 2011, and I guess in other countries exist also laws asking for more growth, as if there would not be these limits of planet Earth. That is a very important issue. So I have to skip some of the exhibits, and come to what I called a prelude. And I said already that there are on the planet several, you can identify several Earth systems, and I mentioned energy, climate, and information. I did not mention the economy as an Earth system because Kenneth Boulding, the economist, not mentioned the economy as an Earth system. It's a very strange idea for an economist that the economy is not an Earth system in state of information and so on and so forth. But the economy, of course, is an Earth system, but an Earth system which is limited and not endlessly growing, as neoliberalism is stating as the normal state of affairs in modern capitalism. And then we have to take into account with regard to the other Earth system, what are the energy systems, what is the impact of the energy system, for instance, on the economic system. And when you have one energy base, which is the solar energy, energy supplied by the rays of the sun, then it is another energy system than one which is based on fossil resources like oil and coal and gas and so on and so forth, which has another impact on the economy as an Earth system, and also on the climate as an Earth system, and probably also on information as an Earth system. So we have to look after the interdependencies of these different Earth systems, which then form the mode of development of the planet Earth, of the global system, but also on each local space on this planet Earth, on the surface of planet Earth. So solar energy, and that is what makes a difference to the fossil energy system, is an open energy system. The source of energy does not come from planet Earth, but from the sun. And that makes a big difference compared to the fossil energy, which does not come from the sun, but very indirectly over millions of years because of the mineralization of biomass, which is produced by solar energy in the crust of the Earth. And then we are tapping these energy sources, and then the new energy source, fossil energy source, is an energy source stemming from planet Earth itself. So that the energy system, because we are using fossil energy more than solar energy, is a limited energy system. That makes a decisive difference. The solar energy system, however, is dependent on natural time and space. And of course, that makes also a difference for the understanding of our environment. When it is limited in time and space, then it is different from an understanding as if there are no limits of time and space, because we can use fossil energy in the morning, in the evening, at night, at day, in winter, in summer, and so on and so forth. That is impossible with solar arrays, with an open energy system. And that makes our consciousness as well as our activities very different in a solar energy system compared with a fossil one, and vice versa. And we are measuring the energy intensity and the use of energy. We can use solar energy, and over hundred thousands of years, human beings have used the rays of the sun as the only and decisive energy source. This energy source was not a very powerful one compared with this fossil energy source. And the measurement of the force of these energy sources is the so-called energy return on energy invested. This energy return on energy invested in case of the solar energy system is rather low compared to the fossil energy system, where it is rather high. The energy return of coal or of oil or fossil gas is much higher than that from biomass. And therefore, it is very favorable for human activities, especially for human activities in production, so that the surplus is growing, and therefore, but that is has to be explained it much more at length. Therefore, it is only possible to base a capitalist system which needs a high surplus and high growth rates only on fossil energy sources and not on solar energy forces. That is perhaps one of the hindrances to transform the fossil energy system under capitalist conditions today into an energy system based on renewable solar energy. So we have to change also the natural system and how to use different energies and to bring it in coordinates, to bring it into compatibility with the social system. So we see the social system and its organization has to do with the organization of the energy system, with one of the earth systems, and then with the information system, and so on and so forth. And when you do not the one, then you cannot do the other. And that is very important to understand when we speak about transformation of the energy system, on the energy revolution, on the transformation to green energies instead of black and brown energies, and so on. And Birgit, I think, will speak about this at more at length. And the industrial revolution, therefore, which occurred 250 years ago, first in England, in Europe, and then all over the world, only was possible because the energy return on energy invested could be increased by using fossil energy instead of solar energy. So this energy transformation, this transformation of the energy system was very favorable for human development and was to a certain extent a progress which has been interpreted as progressive one in history and in social sciences. So I'm going to skip other exhibits in order to go ahead with some kind of a conclusion. We have in history of mankind in the last many thousands of years, let us say, since the end of the Ice Ages, that was 11,700 years ago on Earth, in average, more or less, we have several energy systems. We can observe several energy systems, but only three are interesting for us to understand the development in the past and future development. We had a pre-fossil energy system based on an external energy source, that is the sun. I already spoke about it. Then we have times of transition from a solar energy system to a fossil energy system. Then we have, since the Industrial Revolution at the end of the 18th century in England, beginning in England and then spreading all over the world, the fossil energy system, and we are in this system also today, but we know that it is coming to an end, and then we will have another post-fossil energy system. That's the only chance which mankind has. Can it be a post-fossil energy system as it was in the pre-fossil world? Probably not, because the Earth is developing and nothing is repeating in history, and therefore we have to be aware that the post-fossil renewable energy system will be very different from the pre-fossil energy system. But we don't know exactly how this will be. That is the question which has to be decided by our this generation and the next generation. That is a future task, and it is a future challenge of the development of mankind. Well, we could speak about the characteristic of these different energy systems, but the time is not enough to do that. Therefore, I skip this exhibit, and only say that the most important and interesting times are the times of the transition from one energy system to another. The transition from the pre-fossil to the fossil energy system was rather simple. Why was it simple? There were conflicts, there was battles, there were war about it. Of course, it was not so simple, but in principle it was simple, because the energy return on energy invested in the fossil energy system was much higher than in the system based on solar rays before. And the question is it so simple in the transition period from the fossil to solar energy system, which will be the future? How does the energy return on energy invested develop in the future? We have no answer on it. There are no secure informations and knowledges about these energy systems which are following each other. We only know, and we have to be aware, that there will be such a transition, because fossil system is coming to an end. Maybe in 20 years, maybe in 30 years, maybe in 100 years, but it will come to an end, and then the transition is absolutely necessary. But we have to be optimistic, because when there was a pre-fossil capitalism, then perhaps there can be a post-fossil capitalism. Or is it different? Because the post-fossil capitalism cannot base on a higher energy return on energy invested, as in pre-fossil times, because the transition was very favorable for mankind, because it was a transition to a higher energy return on energy invested under capitalist auspices. And will it be the same in the next transition? And I would say, and many others say the same, it will not be. And we have to find some other solutions for this problem. So far, it is an open question which we have to take into consideration. Well, I'm looking for the exhibit now. No. So this is also skipped, and the question is how to understand these differences of the transition processes. In order to understand this, you need always, when you want to understand something, you need categories in order to interpret these developments. And one of the basic categories to understand the transitions of the energy systems in combination with the transitions in the social system and in the political system, all is intertwined. It is the best to follow the idea of Karl Marx, who said that the double character of all social processes is a basic point in interpreting and understanding the contradictions of the development process under capitalism. So we have to be aware of the double character of all economic processes, because economic processes always are social transformations. There are transformations in the economic system in terms of value transformations. In the economic system, it only makes sense to produce when there is a result, a surplus, surplus value, surplus money called profit or surplus value, as you, what you like. You must have a surplus in the economic system that is comparable to the surplus in the energy system. You invest energy in order to get more energy out of it. And in the economic system, you invest value, you invest money in order to get more as a result. That is logically very comparable. And therefore, the use of fossil energy with a high ROE is also the basis for producing a high surplus in the economic system. That is, so to say, logically on the same line. And therefore, capitalism has functioned so fine, so well, so smoothly, because it was in combination and in coordinates with the energy system as an Earth system. So you have also two categories to measure these surpluses. In the economic system, you have the profit rate, or in modern approaches, which are not based on Marx critical political economy, you can say shareholder value, everybody has heard about it, is also a surplus in comparison with the investment undertaken, shareholder value, or in Keynesian terminology, you can say returns on capital and other terms can be used. And you have the same measure in the energy system when you say energy return on energy invested. That is like more money out of an invested monetary sum. So it is logically coexistent and it fits together perfectly. In the economic system, you have value transformations. In the energy system, however, you have no value transformations in terms of increase, but you have qualitative changes. I will show this a little bit more extensively because it is so important. It is important also in the history of social thinking. And I had a part in this lecture, but I will skip it because time is running out. When you look into the development of social thinking to Aristotle 300 years before Christ, or to the physiocrats in the early 18th century, or to Adam Smith at the end of the 18th century, or to the physiocrats and John Stuart Mill and so on, or Jevons, the great economists, or Karl Marx, then you will find considerations around this big problem in a period of transformation at the end of the 18th century. In a period of transformation, the challenges are more clearly than in other periods of development, and therefore you have more interesting theoretical findings in these periods than in others. But I don't argue about this anymore because it is too much. I have not the time to do that. I come to the end and show that the result of the transformation at the end of the 18th century was, so to say, a new capitalist trinity. The trinity between the energy system, it became a fossil energy system, not immediately, but over a long term period in the 19th century, and then also in the 20th century, and we are still in such a transformation. Period, but it is a double transformation now. Still, we are transforming the economic system to include fossil energy, but on the other hand, we are more going to include renewable energy, energy from biomass, solar energy, wind energy, and so on and so forth. But the capitalist trinity was possible because fossil energy is so favorable for capitalist profit making because of this compatibility of ROI and the profit rate. And it is also important, the Occidental rationality, which becomes more and more the basis. It's not only in the heads, but also in the machinations of the instruments which we use, that this rationality, technical rationality, is predominant in all the developments in the economy as well as in technical manipulations. And then, and that is not very important, the third element of this trinity is money. Money as a social form which allows the production of these surpluses which are necessary in energy, this energy return on energy investment, as well as in the economy in the form of profit. You need this logic in money, but as a real logic which is inscribed into the real development of the capitalist system, and we know that it is not only real in this system, but also powerful in this system. It is a very violent power, money, which is ruling the world today. And the most important expressions of this violence of money in this trinity, that is the debt crisis of our times, which began in the 80s of the last century in Mexico, you know, the Mexican debt crisis, Brazil, in Latin America in general, and then it continued until today, until Greece, where we have the deepest debt crisis now in Europe, not in Latin America or in other parts of the third world. It came back to the first world, and showing that this trinity is a very violent trinity, or can be a very violent trinity, and is dominant in the whole development existence. So the system is formed of quantitative increasing growth rates, and in a qualitative sense is growth, accumulation of capital, and accumulation of capital is also the development of the social class formations and the political formations, which are the consequence of class formations and their dynamics and so on and so forth. So the capitalist dynamics and the development of a capitalist system, but based on the energy system, becomes important for the understanding of contemporary phenomena such as the debt crisis, for instance, which has been mentioned, and many other problems from up to peace and peace and war. Well, the result is that it that growth becomes the reality of this dynamic system based on energy and money, capital, and Occidentalist rationality, the Trinity, as I called it. The result is a high growth rate of capital, and that is also of GNP and then also of capital, and that means that the whole society is changing in a way and in a tempo which never existed before in human being. That becomes very clear in this exhibit, which is based on the Millennium Report by a Norwegian statistician, Angus Maddison, who organized it, Millennium Report, a very long-term analysis of capitalist development in the whole world, not only in Europe, but in all parts of the world, over 2,000 years from the birth of Jesus Christ until the year 2000. And it is interesting to see. I will not speak about methodology and so on. There's very problematic points to mention. But the logic is very interesting, and it is very plausible. There was no growth on Earth in the global system until the fossil revolution, with the industrial revolution at the end of the 18th century. There was nearly no growth at all. Therefore, there was no inequality in the world. The per capita income, so long as you believe that you can measure it over such a long term, Angus Maddison did it, and let us say that it is plausible, not exact, but plausible. He said there was no growth and there was no inequality in the world until the Industrial Revolution. With the Industrial Revolution, then you have the result, which is very visible there, an extreme jump of growth rates and also a greater inequality of developments in the different continents on Earth. And you can repeat this inequality on the local scale, on the national scale, between generations, between gender, and so on. Inequality comes into social beings since the Industrial Revolution in a much more dramatic way than ever before. I would not say that there was no inequality in the world before. There was a lot of inequality. But now it has another character. This has a consequence because the history of high growth rates is rather short. And we think, when we read the reports of OECD and of other international institutions, that it is natural that how growth rates are high, and that nations or governments which are not producing high growth rates are failing governments. They have a bad performance. So you can increase the growth rates. But it was not possible to increase them because the energy system was not compatible with the economic system. And then you cannot increase the growth rates. And that was the case before the Industrial Revolution. Only after the Industrial Revolution, high growth rates became possible. Before, it was not possible. And the question is, when we have to organize a transition to a post-fossil, renewable energy system, will high growth rates be possible again? And I would say probably not. And we could go into detail and analyze what are the growth rates, the basis of the growth rate and so on, but I have not time to be more explicit in this respect. But the problem is also very clear. When there is inequality growing, then you have more struggle in the world, class struggle, because inequality is also the inequality of classes in the capitalist world. The ones have money, they are the creditors. The others have no money, they are the debtors. But both are necessary for the working of the whole system. And therefore, this inequality is a structural one, and it reproduces itself, and it is responsible for the power structure of the whole system. Well, that is the basis for that. What is the consequence of these high growth rates? There's a fetishism of growth. The fetishism of growth is very important in the political and economic discourses, which you also learn in the university seminars, in the UNAM, as well as in my university, the Free University in Berlin. Insofar, it is also globalization of economic discourses which is happening, and that's not for the best of the development of the economic science. But everybody believes that growth is good for the poor, is good to grow out of debts, and so on and so forth. I gave some of the arguments which you surely know here, and I will not go into detail, only by saying that if it is possible to grow out of debt, then you need high growth rates. But what happens for countries which have to grow out of debt when they have not the possibility to organize a high energy return on energy invested because they are running short of fossil energy? like it is the case in the case of like it is so in the case of Greece. They cannot produce these high growth rates. Therefore, they are sinking in the debt pyramid, and they have no chance to come out. And therefore, the solution of the debt crisis, which we are looking for all over the world, is not possible in a capitalist environment in which the energy return is, yes, okay, introduce non-conventional energy sources, as it is the case with fracking oil and gas and going into deep sea oil and so on and so forth. You know that, I guess I could speak longer about this, but that is not possible. And you have another limits to increase the growth rate because of the so-called rebound effect. When you increase the efficiency of extraction of energy sources, then you make them more inexpensive, and that means also that the market laws are controlling the development of the whole system. When a commodity becomes more inexpensive, cheaper, then of course it is more used. It will be more used to a higher extent, and then you have the negative effects of using this energy source in multiplied. And therefore, the rebound effect is very negative for the substitution of fossil energy by other energy forces. Okay, I could speak at length about the fossil energy chain and then differentiate between the energy system and the climate system, which I mentioned as one of the Earth system but did not analyze it. That would be possible. We would speak about the limits to growth by saying that these are limits on the input side of energy sources, which is called peak of the extraction of all the energy sources of oil, of coal, and so on and so forth. And you have limits also on the output side, on the emission side of energy. When you look to the greenhouse gases which are emitted into the atmosphere and other gases as well, and you have limits also of other material which are necessary for the transformation of renewable energy sources into working energy. And it is very famous, this graph, which I which I show here, where some of the energy and necessities for survival of mankind, like nitrogen and so on, are running out. That is a graph presented by the IPCC, the International Panel, Interparliamentarian, I have to say, a panel on climate change, a very official graph, which shows that we are coming to an end of all that. And therefore, we have to take one thing into account, which Naomi Klein mentioned in her book about capitalism and climate, saying more or less, in order to save the climate, it is necessary to fight capitalism. And that is especially important for younger persons on the world, because they have to draw the consequences out of that what the older generation in the last decades did, not respecting the limits of planet Earth in the long term, in the super long term history, as well as in the very short term. history. I stop here, although there are many, many other points to be mentioned, but some of them will be mentioned by Birgit Mahnkopf and the others. You have to work about and find solutions for the survival of everybody, individual, but also of mankind. Thanks a lot for your attention.